Good morning. Over the years, everybody has become familiar with the Marvel heroes. There is, however, one hero that has not gotten the just recognition that they need. And I wish to start my lecture out by giving that recognition. Our very own thyroid man. In doing research for this lecture, I came across, by accident, all of these interesting products, and I'm just going to put them under the topic, what were they thinking? And hopefully it'll be interesting enough to keep even Jamis awake. In the early 1900s through to about the mid-1940s, radium was all the rage. It had magical powers, and even physicians recognized that these magical powers could be used to renew worn-out body cells. Products began appearing in the marketplace to give people the radium that they needed for the magical powers. On the top left is the Revigorator. It was a clay earthen container in which radium ore was mixed with the clay. It was fired and you had this vessel. You would fill the vessel with water and let it set. Radium would actually leach into the water from the ore, and the water became radioactive with radium. It was suggested that the public drink 6 to 8 glasses of this every day. It has been thought that the Revigorator itself has killed over a few thousand people. The radium settled in the bones, causing bone tumors. The marrow was irradiated, causing anemia. It was a slow and painful death. In the middle is actually radium chocolate. Chocolate that had radium infused in it. On the top right, you could actually purchase radioactive water if you couldn't have a Revigorator of your own. And of course, the all and favorite snowflake uranium infused ice cream. And now the boring stuff. Thyroid imaging, the technologist's perspective. The basic preparation was consistent of two things. The patient was either imaged after withdrawal or the patient was imaged after a round of thyrogen. For the withdrawal method, the patient has had all their thyroid medications and all iodine-containing substances removed from their diet. One of the areas often overlooked is contrast media. The patient should be off of intravenous contrast media for at least 2 months, and some of the oil-based intrathecal agents 3 to 6 months. Included in our SOP is this picture. It shows all the common medications, all the common supplies of iodine, and how long the people should be off of it. The second method of patient prep is thyrogen injections. Although you still have to be wary of contrast agents given in radiology, but otherwise besides that, diet and medications are no longer considered. The patient is given 2 consecutive doses, usually on a Monday and Tuesday. On the third day, the patient is dosed with the I-123 and I-131 and then imaging follows. If it, however, is an NM075, that is an entirely different animal, and I'll be discussing that later. It is the technologist's responsibility, before dosing the patient, be sure that they have been NPO for 4 hours, that there is a pregnancy test that is no older than 48 hours if the patient is in childbearing age and has had no surgeries to prevent pregnancy. A complete patient medication history should be taken, and preferably this should be done before scheduling, and that a complete radiology diagnostic procedure history being taken. Ask the patients if in radiology if they've ever drank something, were injected with something, or had something placed in their spinal canal in the past few weeks. In thyroid imaging, there's actually only 4 isotopes that we really have to worry about: technetium, cobalt, I-131, and I-123. Technetium can be imaged on a dual-headed camera with either low-energy, high-resolution collimators or a pinhole. The energy window for technetium is set at 20%, centered over 140 keV. Cobalt 57 is actually used as a marker for the anterior thyroid image and can also be used in fused imaging. If you use it with I-123, there are some considerations you need to do in changing the windows. For the marker image, a dual window for cobalt 57 and I-123 is set for a 10% window centered on 122 keV and a 20% window centered on 159 keV. This dual window configuration allows the marker to be visualized on the I-123 planar image. And finally, I-131. It too can be imaged on a dual-headed camera with either a high-energy parallel hole collimator or a high-energy rated pinhole. The energy windows are set at 20%, centered on 364 keV. In the early 1920s, barium radium tablets came into being. They were advertised as the substance of sunshine. And if you look at the ad on the bottom right, for men, it promised strength, power, and endurance, and for women, energy, beauty, radiance. NM040, the I-131 uptake. The uptake dose for I-131 is usually 7 to 10 microcuries, and it was given orally. To perform the uptake, you need 2 pieces of equipment. You need a uptake probe with a flat field collimator and a single crystal, and also a neck phantom. The probe should be centered on I-131. The actual procedure. On the first day, you will count the room background for 60 seconds. Place the dose in the neck phantom and count it for 60 seconds at the same distance of 25 centimeters. Dose the patient. Instruct the patient not to have anything to eat or drink for 2 additional hours. On the second day, the patient returns. You count the patient's background on the thigh just above the knee at a standard distance of 25 centimeters for 60 seconds, and then count the patient's thyroid centered on the thyroid area for a standard distance of 25 cm for 60 seconds. I have had multiple students ask me in the past, why do we pick the knee for the patient's background? If you were to look at a cross-section of the thigh and a cross-section of the neck, you would find that they have very similar structures and tissues. There is soft tissue centered around a single bone. NM001 Thyroid Imaging with Technetium. This used to be a popular and standard way of doing an uptake and scan, but has become less and less popular these days. When it is done, the patient is given 10 millicuries IV and they wait 20 minutes. At the end of 20 minutes, they're given a glass of water to clear the esophagus. Perform an anterior planar image with a cobalt 57 marker placed on the suprasternal notch for 250K minimum. If the uptake performed and it was less than 3%, no other imaging was usually required. If the uptake is greater than 3%, acquire pinhole images. When performing technetium pinhole images, a measuring device is used to keep the distance from the end of the collimator to the neck the same. Most technologists have figured out, depending on the size of their hand, that that is either 2 or 3 fingers worth of distance. You are going to have some patients who you cannot get that close. You will have the no-neck patients, or you will have women with extremely large breasts. In these cases, adjust the collimator distance to maximize the size of the thyroid, and to also consider you need to have that distance for all 3 views. 3 images are required: an anterior, a 30-degree RAO, a 30-degree LAO, and it's done for 250K or 10 minutes, whichever happens first. Also, on that film, be sure to annotate what the patient's I-131 uptake was. After the imaging is complete, the OD will examine the patient's neck. If they find a palpable nodule, an additional anterior image should be performed. The OD will place either a hot or cold marker directly on top of the palpable nodule. The technologist will center the pinhole collimator on that marker and acquire an image for 250K or 10 minutes, whichever happens first. Be sure to annotate your uptake on your images. Generally, as a rule, the technetium scan and the I-131 uptake are done in pairs. One of the problems with the technetium scan is, depending upon what the nodules look like, the OD may have requested an additional follow-up of I-123. I-123 is now more available than it was in the past, so I'm glad to see that this trend has now started. The radium appliance company that was established in 1916 decided that if you took radium, put it in a pad, the patient could apply the pad to their skin. It was recommended that they wore the pad on their back during the day and on their abdomen while they slept. Thousands wrote that it healed them of neuritis, rheumatism, high blood pressure, constipation, nervous prostration, whatever that is, asthma, and other respiratory diseases. Heart, lung, liver, and bladder troubles were cured. Unfortunately, they developed rather large skin burns. NM010, thyroid uptake and imaging using I-123. The pharmaceutical is I-123. The dose is in the range of 200 to 400 microcuries. The procedure is to count the capsule and give it orally. The patient is kept in PO for 2 hours after dosing. Wait 4 to 6 hours, give the patient a glass of water to clear the esophagus, and acquire a dual energy cobalt I-123 anterior planar image with the cobalt marker placed on the SSN, and acquire the image for at least 250K. After performing the I-123 uptake, just like you did for an NM-001, look at the uptake. If it's less than 3%, no other image is required. If it's greater than 3%, pinholes are required. Of course, collimator pinhole distance is important. Just remember, there are standard distances that you have to use, and that's usually 2 to 3 fingers. The 3 standard pinhole images are the anterior 30-degree RAO, 30-degree LAO. You image for 250K counts or 20 minutes, whichever happens first. Be sure to annotate the uptake and isotope on the image. This is an example of what the finished product looks like. You have annotated the cobalt marker, the uptake is on there, the isotope is on there, and there is a total of 4 images. And again, if the physician finds a palpable nodule, additional imaging may be required using a cold or hot marker. Just be sure to center on the marker and acquire your image for 250K or 20 minutes, whichever happens first. Another popular way of exposing yourself to radium was to use a salve or a cream. They were embedded with radium or thorium, and you rub them on those trouble areas to make the blemishes fade away. They actually burned away. NM-030 Whole Body I-131 Withdrawal Metastatic Survey, our standard neck and chest using I-131. Their pharmaceuticals I-131. The dose is 4 millicuries. It is given orally. The patient is kept MPO 2 hours after the dose. At Fort Belvoir Community Hospital, we have found it easier to count the 1% standard at the time of dosing. People seem to have an issue with putting the correct data in if you try to put the data for dosing on a different day. Prior to imaging, have the patient drink a glass of water to clear the esophagus. The patient must remove their above-the-waist clothing. They need to cleanse their neck, chest, and back, then don on a patient gown. Perform an uptake. If the uptake data should be adjusted to 2 decimal spaces to the left because there was a 1% standard. All images are obtained 48 to 72 hours after the administration of the radiopharmaceutical. Pinhole imaging. We take 2 images. One image is taken with cobalt markers placed on the thyroid and suprasternal notch, and the second image is a pinhole of the exact same area using the I-131 window. What is important in positioning is that the thyroid marker be placed directly in the center of the field of view. By raising the collimator up and down and changing the magnification, move the collimator so that the substernal notch marker is just barely visible. And this is an example of correct positioning and incorrect positioning. On the left, the thyroid marker is not centered. You're cutting off tissue at the top of the neck. And the SSN marker is in the field of view, indicating that the collimator is too far away from the patient. On the right side, it is centered. The collimator is moved so that the marker on the SSN is barely visible. This is your maximum magnification that you can do for this patient. In imaging the pinhole, again, the first pinhole image is a 15-second image using the cobalt 57 energy window. The second pinhole image, remove the markers, do not move the patient, reset the isotope energy to the range of I-131 and proceed with a 150K or 20-minute image, whichever occurs first. We have found from experience that if you start going beyond the 150K, you start getting a star effect and the image is greatly diminished. And when you're finished, please be sure to return your markers to the pharmacy. This is the final product of what the pinhole images will look like. On the bottom left is a marker image only. On the top is the actual neck image with the pinhole. And on the right is the fused image to give the OD reference points as to where the hot spot is in relationship to the SSN and the thyroid. Be sure to annotate the uptake and isotope on this image. In conjunction with the pinhole images, a whole body image is done. Acquire an anterior-posterior image of the whole body set on the correct isotope, I-131. The imaging should be from the top of the head to the mid-thighs. It is preferred that the imaging be at 4 centimeters a minute if your machine will allow you to go that slow. If not, use the slowest possible speed that you can get, above the 4 cm. This is what your display will look like. You will have light images on the left, and you will have darker images on the right. Be sure to put your isotope and uptake on this film. Please disregard that I put I-123. I forgot to make an I-131 image. The I-131 thyrogen neck and chest. From the perspective of the technologist, the imaging is performed identically to both of these. The only difference is that the patient received thyrogen 2 days prior to dosing. All other parameters remain the same. This is an interesting product. It is a 15-day course of radium or thorium infused wax suppositories. Can you imagine exposing your colon to radium for 15 days? NM031, the I-123 withdrawal metastatic survey. The dose is 2 to 3 millicuries of I-123 and it's given orally. The patient is kept NPO 2 hours after the dose. At Fort Belvoir Community Hospital, we count the 10% standard at the time of dosing. One of the differences between Fort Belvoir Community Hospital and Walter Reed is that at Fort Belvoir Community Hospital, we cannot purchase one capsule for 3 millicuries. We have to do it in the form of 10 capsules. We take one of the capsules, which is 10% of the dose, and we actually use that as the standard. At Walter Reed, the pharmacy prepares a 1% standard for you. With a 10% standard, we have to move our decimal place one place to the left. At Walter Reed, you have 1%, which means you will still have to move your decimal place to the left 2 places. And just like in the I-131, for I-123, the patient still drinks a full glass of water. The patient removes their clothes. They wash up good. They put on a gown. The images are required 24 hours after the administration of the radiopharmaceutical. Just as in the I-131, you have to be careful about positioning the markers, and the I-123. Your cobalt marker should be placed on the thyroid, on the substernal notch, center the thyroid to your field of view, adjust your collimator to the maximum magnification, and start your image. I know this slide is redundant, but I can't stress enough the importance of proper positioning. The pinhole images are acquired just exactly like you would do the I-131, except you're using I-123. As discussed, your first pinhole is a marker image. The energy range is for cobalt 57. Your second image in exactly the same position is I-123. You acquire for 150K or 20 minutes, whichever happens first, and the marker is always returned to the pharmacy when imaging is complete. Again, a correct image to present to the OD. The whole body image is acquired exactly like you did for the I-131. The only difference is you have it set on I-123. You use a low energy collimator for I-123, a high energy collimator for I-131. Again, adjust your scanning speed to 4 centimeters a minute if your machine will go that slow. If not, use the slowest that the machine will give you. Image from the top of the head to the middle of the thigh. And a display of what the OD would expect to see from your whole body imaging. NM034, the whole body I-123 thyrogen stimulated metastatic survey. Again, from the technologist's perspective, there is no difference between the withdrawal and the thyrogen I-123 neck and chest. The only difference is the thyrogen was given 2 days prior. After that, dosing, imaging, timelines are all the same. In France, a cosmetic line was developed called Thoradia. They used thorium and they used radium in the makeup. It was in the powder, the foundation, the perfume, the shampoo, the conditioner, the lipstick. These poor women irradiated their face, hair, neck, and developed burns, some women blindness, loss of hair. But you have to admit, if you look at the pictures, they certainly were radiant. And finally, NM075, the I-123 whole body thyrogen and the metastatic I-123 therapy. This protocol was developed to utilize the thyrogen's properties on the I-131 therapy. Dosing on this is, however, is critical. It is important that on the second day of the thyrogen injection, that injection be given at the earliest possible time in the AM. The I-123 dose is given mid-afternoon that same day. The more time that you can spend between the actual thyrogen and dosing, the better it is for the patient. Imaging is then performed the next day, 18 to 24 hours. And again, from the important perspective of the technologist, there is no difference in imaging. The images are done identically to an I-123 neck and chest. And immediately after that, the patient is given their I-131 therapy, and 7 to 12 days later, they will get their follow-up neck and chest. So in summary, if for thyroid imaging, whether you use technetium or I-123, the images are the same. A planar with a marker, 3 pinholes. If you're performing a neck and chest, the imaging is the same for I-123 as it is for I-131. A marker image, a neck image, and a whole body. And I think the best product that the idiots used in the 20s was a product for men. It was for revitalization and an energizing experience, is how it was advertised. These were radium-infused condoms. I know this was a long, drawn-out lecture, and I thank you all for listening. I had a lot of material to cover, and I tried to do it as quickly as possible. And of course, I have to end a slide with the obligatory Tony Cat slide. Y'all have a good day, and thank you.